If Hollywood made a movie about Manny Jackson's life, reviewers may well say, well, that's a nice story, but it can't happen. It's just a fairy tale. Well, you're looking tonight at a real-life fairy tale. He was born in a railroad boxcar, spent his early years in great poverty, often living with 12 family members. When he was 3, his family moved to Edwardsville. His father got some work. He worked 2 jobs, as a matter of fact. He was an inspiration to Manny. Manny was among the second group of black students to enroll in Edwardsville High School when school segregation ended. 4 boys and 3 girls had to endure the racism that still existed. But Manny was a terrific basketball player and helped Edwardsville High reach the state finals for the first time. Manny and team member Governor Vaughn went to the University of Illinois on scholarships, and they were the first black players to start for the Illini. After college, he failed to make the NBA. He played for the Harlem Globetrotters for a while, but left to study economics and work at General Motors. Later, he went to work for Honeywell, and it wasn't long before he became one of the company's highest executives. He co-founded the Executive Leadership Council, a group of African-American corporate executives from various industries. In 1993, when the Harlem Globetrotters' popularity was in decline and near bankrupt, he bought the team and rebuilt the brand and helped that iconic franchise regain its status as one of America's favorites again. Manny continues to give back. He donated $2 million to start the Manny L. Jackson Illinois Academic Enrichment and Leadership Program, which provides a host of academic and social programs. Manny was awarded the Order of Lincoln, the state's highest honor, in 2010. There's so much of this man's life and legacy for this introduction to cover. It's not a fairy tale, but an inspirational real-life story. So the St. Louis Sports Hall of Fame is honored to induct Manny L. Jackson.
My goodness. Manny, congratulations. Where is Ilmo, Missouri?
God knows. Well, I'll tell you, it has to be near the Illinois-Missouri line. That kind of makes sense, doesn't it?
It kind of does.
It's near Saxton and Cape Dorada. And
how many years were you there before you got up to Edwardsville?
How many floods were there? Because what happened, when it flooded, we had to come out of there. Uh-huh. And my grandfather came down once, and he said, I can't do this anymore. And my grandfather said, where are you taking us to? He said, a little town called Edwardsville. We complained, like hell, I could hear him just complaining in the front of the truck going up. And that was the start of my life right there.
How many in your family?
There were 13 in that boxcar.
Oh, yeah. 13.
We were comfortable.
It was a banquet every night.
Party all the time. Party, party, party.
Yeah. Well, you got to Illinois, and you not only were the first to start on an Illini team, you were named to the All-America team, and you were 2-time All-Big Ten. What position did you play, and what were the Illinois teams like there?
Well, I'm going to give a tribute to all of you know, if you've heard of Governor Vaughn, a good buddy, and I wouldn't have made it without Governor going through the kind of things we had to endure during those days. But both Governor and I would say right now that the gentleman was introduced earlier, Don Ohl, was the catalyst for what we did. And I'll say this in the context of everything was segregated back in those days. The NBA was segregated. The schools were basically segregated. We essentially knew our place. There were restaurants across the street from the gym, and we'd play at night. And the white ball players would go and sit in the front of the restaurant. And Gov and I would sit in the kitchen or in the back. There was one guy that never gave a shit about color. His name was Don Ohl. Donald could play with us, talk to us, run with us, joke with us, like I'd never seen a person his color do before. I remember Mom making a peach pie for us to carry back to University of Illinois. And Don had a black Mercury he'd drive in and take us up there. He jam-stopped that thing. He always drove faster than he should have. He did everything faster than he should have done. He stopped that thing, and that pie came through the front, back through the front, fast our faces into the windshield, and freaking Don never missed a beat. He kept right on going. Now, I should tell you, the team averaged 100 plus
points per game with Don and Gov and I. The problem is our opposition averaged 105 or so. But Don never saw a shot.
He didn't like it.
And I'll tell you, he was in fast company. Because the three of us were chasing that ball like crazy. Think about three ball players in the same high school playing at the University of Illinois, and every team in the Big Ten around the country feared us like crazy. We had a good time, and it was made easy because Don Aldis didn't give a crap. He just wanted to play. He wanted to play, and he wanted to play hard. I'll tell you one last thing. I've been chairman of the Basketball Hall of Fame. It put me in a position to meet a lot of ball players, older ball players. And when they find out I'm from Medford, Illinois, and knew Don Old, black, white, or indifferent, they'd all say, "That's the baddest dude they ever met. Baddest white dude they ever met." I'll stop now. Go ahead.
How'd you get to the Globetrotters?
Thank you, Donald. Abe Saberstein recruited me out of high school. And when he found out that I had connections at Illinois, he reversed the recruiting. And he said, "You have to finish college and come see me." And Abe always thought of himself as being a University of Illinois guy. And the best decision that I made was to stay at U of I. And that decision for Abe to leave me back in the University of Illinois changed my life, actually. And then after I played through 4 years of college, I made another good decision, which was not to play in a college all-star game, to do a tour of the country over 26 days, which meant you had to lose your last semester of college. And I said, "I'm not going to do the tour. I'll keep going and graduate." And Abe encouraged me to do that. And then when I finished college, Abe said, "You're ready now." And I said, "I got a chance to go to the National Industrial Basketball League because my buddy Don Old went to Peoria Caterpillars." And I said, "I wanted to see what that's like because I have a chance to work and also play basketball." I went to New York and played for the Tuck Tapers. Abe came out one day and he said, "Aren't you tired of working for a living?" And he made a persuasive argument. He said, "You know, you want to be in business." He said, "The world's going to go global one of these days, the business world." He said, "You join the team, I'll take you around the world, and I'll show you what business is like in every country in the world." Well, I look back on that. I've been to 105 countries. I've negotiated contracts just about in every language you can think of. And I saw the world through the eyes of Abe Saberstein. He kept his promise, and I never looked back after that. So I'll start.
That's a story. So you're on the board of six international companies. You were a senior vice president of Honeywell, a Fortune 500 company. So you've been in big, big business.
Yeah. Black folks didn't have an easy time getting ahead in the corporate world. And it's kind of like I look at what's happening to our country now. You got to get to the head before the body makes the right decision. And when I took over as chairman or president of the Executive Leadership Council, I used to tell my African-American friends that we can't work ourselves from the bottom. We've got to get to the heads of the people at the top. And they look at me and say, "No way." And I made the decision I was going to go to every corporation that everybody that complimented me on basketball or my work in corporations said, "Who's on your board of directors?" And they'd say, "Well, we don't have one of you guys yet." I knew what that meant. But whenever I got on the board, I was the ultimate contrarian. And being the ultimate contrarian, they'd be valuable to board members. And I was embraced and endorsed by CEOs of actually 11 companies. And the top Fortune 500, the six Fortune 500 guys became my best buddies. They referred me to other places, and I enjoyed being a contrarian on boards in the petrochemical industry and sports. Stanley Tool. I enjoyed being on boards that were in transition because I liked creating new markets. Long before it was branding, I had the idea that you had to have an identity. And my first branding experience was at Honeywell, a diversified company, and they said, "What are we?" And I said, "You're in one business. You're in a comfort business. People have come to trust you." And that became a byline that made the Wall Street Journal and other places. I got calls from companies to be on their board. Help them identify who they were and what they were about.
Well, in 2015, you received the NCAA's prestigious Theodore Roosevelt Award for Outstanding Lifetime Achievements. That had to be a really feel-good moment there.
It was good. You know, people see me now and they say, "What do you do for a living?" And someone asked me the other night, "I don't know what I do for a living." I tell young people, "Hit the lottery." Because I got lucky. I left Elmore, Missouri, became a basketball player in Edwardsville, ended up in University of Illinois, and suddenly I got enough money to do what I want to do. When I got the money to do what I want to do, hit the lottery, I said, I'm going to give back to Edwardsville. Those folks there are just great, and they got me started. They made everything work for me. And I said, I'm going to give back to University of Illinois because that school and the people there embraced me like crazy. And my start was there. Wherever in the world I said, University of Illinois, people would say, wow, you must be legit. And I never lost the notion that basketball, whether I liked it or not, it made it all possible. And this young lady here was saying that I avoided putting basketball on my resumes. I thought they'd think I'm just another jock. And I realized the most valuable asset I had was this competitive inner spirit and team-building attitude I had that made me valuable in business. So the University of Illinois, basketball in my hometown are my recipients of all my donations.
So can the folks get the book? Manny wrote a book called Boxcars to Boardrooms. Is it still out there?
Still out there. You know, the biggest buyer of that book are the Koreans.
Uh-oh.
Is that amazing?
North or South?
South Korea. Isn't that amazing? Of all the copies I sold, they bought the most of them. And it's an interesting story. I wrote a letter. It's really a letter to my daughters to let them know the improbable story. And we'll stop now.
Well, Manny Jackson, it's a pleasure to welcome you into the St. Louis Sports Hall of Fame, the self-made man from right here in Illinois.
I'm honored. Thank you.
Incredible story. That was a riveting interview, I'll tell you what. I get chills sitting here listening to Manny.